Hi, I'm Ralph Douglas West, pastor of the Church Without Walls. I'm so excited you've joined us today. Our heart is to usher lost souls to Christ and empower believers toward spiritual maturity. I'm thrilled to share that heart with you today through the life-transforming power of God's Word. I also want to invite you to get daily encouragement by signing up for my free devotional at ralphdouglaswest.org. Again, I'm so glad you're with us today. I pray you'll be encouraged. If you've been around this church for some years, you know that there is a psalm that has been specifically written and called the New Year's Psalm. It's Psalm 63. And as often as the Holy Spirit allows me to revisit this passage, I try to do it. You'll see why once you hear it. Psalm 63, a psalm of David when he was in the wilderness of Judah. O God, you're my God. Early will I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh longs for you in a dry and thirsty land where there is no water. So I look for you in the sanctuary to see your power and your glory. Because your loving kindness is better than life, my lips shall praise you. Thus I will bless you while I live. I will lift up my hands in your name. My soul shall be satisfied as with marrow and fatness, and my mouth shall praise you with joyful lips when I remember you on my bed. I meditate on you in the night watches because you have been my help. Therefore, in the shadow of your wings, I will rejoice. My soul follows close behind you. Your right hand upholds me. But those who seek my life to destroy it shall go into the lower parts of the earth. They shall fall by the sword. They shall be a portion of the jackals. But the king shall rejoice in God. Everyone who swears by him shall glory. But the mouth of those who speak lies shall be stopped. This is the word of God. You may be seated. When you've tried everything, at least you thought you had, trust God. It's a psalm for the new year. Frederick Buechner is a Presbyterian theologian. In his autobiographical writings, Buechner makes a comment that almost each time I read anything autobiographical, it surfaces to my conscience that much of autobiography is theology. This is not an aloof psalm. This is not a psalm written by a community of people. This is a hymn for the sanctuary written from the pen of a young man that has traced his steps from obscurity to public popularity. From the field of his father, Jesse, to the pinnacle of the throne of God in the holy city of Jerusalem. He is one now who is looking in the rearview mirror, retracing his steps. But where his steps lead him now is in a wilderness land, because his son, the one that mirrors his image, has run him out of town, separated him from his friends, disassociated him from his vocation and occupation, has abdicated him from the throne, moved him away from his bank account, can't reach for his credit cards, can't call in any favors, and he finds himself literally in a desert wilderness, and for you and I, proverbially and poetically, in a wasteland. That's the situation of the words that you and I have read tonight. If you didn't know any better, at certain junctures of your life, you would have thought that I was reading pages from your own autobiography. And maybe tonight you say, that is not my experience yet. My response will be, keep on living. No one makes it out of life without stopping by for a moment in the wilderness experience. I wish I could say to you on the last night of this year, on the threshold of a brand new year, that you can make it through life without making a pit stop in the wilderness. And it's indiscriminate to age. It doesn't matter if you're young, coming into the dawn of a new life, at the twilight, at the end, it doesn't matter. Nobody gets through this life without coming through some dry, desiccated, desert, dark, dismal, damnable experience. And when you're in it, you start reaching to try for everything. And some of you tonight, you have come to a place where you have tried everything you thought. Trust God. I could sit down right now. That would be enough to take you on into eternity. When you've tried everything else, make sure that you trust God. Look with me for the next little while at Psalm 63 and some helpful holy hints that David gives to us as pilgrims through this barren land. When you tried it all, he would say to us, don't forget for you to seek God. The opening line, David says to us, this is what I did. I had a passion for God and God alone. Listen to the language that he uses in verse 1, oh my God. It sounds like he's about to give us a lecture in theology, God talk, but it changes when he says, my God. He moves from the theological to the testimonial. He said, this is not a lecture, this is a lifestyle. I'm not about to give you concepts about God and propositions. I want to tell you something personal that I know. This is something I didn't learn in a classroom reading a book. This is something I know from my encounter with God. Oh God, my God. He refers to him in Elohim. He speaks of this God, this creator God, Elohim, my God. This is the foundation of his footing. This is the chain that pulls to the anchor of his life. This is the one that has sturdied him through the instabilities of living. He says, oh God, my God. Notice what he doesn't say. He didn't pray the prayer that I probably would have prayed if I had been separated, distanced, disassociated, and dethroned. I probably would have said, God, you got to get me back to my rightful place. You got to put me back at the pinnacle. You got to put me back in the center of the world. David had enough experience with God that he had learned this, that God was more than what you needed. That might be another word I could stop. For some of you, you may say, you took me all year to get that one word. Stop passionately pursuing privilege and prestige and position and promotion and get a relationship personally with the living Lord, and that'll be all that I need. Notice how he seeks after God. He gives us some hints again. In verse number 1, he says he seeks God with an intensity, but he also seeks God with a totality, and then he ends it with a necessity. Look at the intensity of in which David says he seeks after God. This is our encouragement. He says, seek after God early. Some translations, you probably have it in your hand, says eagerly. Well, whether it's early or eager, you can invert the words. In fact, if you seek God early, you'll seek him eagerly. And if you seek him eagerly, you'll seek him early. David often talked about how he got up in the morning and spent time with God early, eagerly. Does he seek God with a sense of intensity? It's a word for passion. And most of us tonight, we are obsessed with people that have a passion for one thing. One thing kind of people amaze us. I won't go through the litany of it, but most of us were captivated not just in the competition of Rio de Janeiro 2016 Olympics, but when we heard the stories and the prices of the passion of these competing amateurs, we got excited when we thought about how some had moved away from their home, wake up early in the morning, run 2 miles, eat breakfast, run 2 more miles, come back, exercise for 2 hours, run for 4 more miles, and then come in and rest, and then get up early in the morning and repeat this, not for one day, but 6 days out of the week, taking one Sabbath and getting back to it to compete sometimes for no more than 1 minute. That's what you call passion, intensity. Tonight, if you can give that kind of time and energy to your occupation, profession, your career, what would happen if we gave some seeking intensity to want to know more about God? Seek God with intensity. I was talking to Ralph one night and I was rehearsing with him the story of Truett Caffey, the founder of Chick-fil-A. And the story, for those of you that don't know Chick-fil-A and Truett Caffey, he got his name from George Washington Truett, who was a long-term pastor at First Baptist Dallas, Truett Caffey. Everything that Truett's name was associated with, whether it was Baylor Hospital, Baylor University, has succeeded. It succeeded also in Truett Caffey's endeavor to make chicken. But you know what he doesn't cook up? He doesn't cook back, thigh, or leg, breast of chicken. That's all he cooks. Whatever you get breast of chicken. Give me a leg, can't get it here. He's built an empire on one part of the chicken. In fact, the people that would tell you that if you want another part of the chicken, you can go to any other chicken shack, but when you come here, you get one thing. It may be baked, it may be fried, honey glazed, but it's one thing. Come here for just a moment. One thing is what built his empire. What more would happen to you and I with some sense of intensity if we could just come to God with one thing, like walking through his doors with God on our mind? Not just with an intensity. David says, I sought God with a totality. Notice the words in verse 1, beyond seeking God, he said he did it with his body and with his soul. That's how he sought after God. He said, my soul thirsts for you. My flesh longs for you. It's the image of body and soul. To love God with heart, mind, body, soul, and strength. To worship or love God with emotion and will and passion and attitude and appetite. He says, that's how I seek after God, with a totality. In fact, Jews, when they worship God at the Wailing Wall, it's a fascinating sight. It is just what they say, Wailing Wall. They pray with such intensity that it spills over in the totality of their being. They stand at a wall. They roll up their prayers and place them in the cracks and crevices. They read from the Psalms and they pray their prayers, and when they pray, they rock forward and backwards. I asked, when I was in Jerusalem, one of the tour guides, I asked the docent, and he said, "We take these words from the scripture literally. That when we pray, we do not sit there as a lump on the log, disconnected. We believe the one to whom we pray is real and personal and viable, and we throw all of our weight, not just the spirit invisible, but the body visible. We want God to know that when we pray, we mean business." Seek God not just with an intensity, but with a totality. Worship God with your heart and your mind. You know, in church, sometimes if you're not careful, people will do to church what the Orients do in certain environments. In certain Oriental environments, you take your shoes off. Sometimes in church, people want to take their mind off. And I'll be honest, I don't like mindless Christianity. I'm criticized for it all the time. People sitting here, he think he, no, I don't think I'm anything other than flesh and blood. But God has given me a mind, and I try to fill it with God so that when I talk about God, I can talk about God with some element of intelligence. Nobody gets mad at you as a banker, as a lawyer, as a counselor, as a physician, for you to come across and sound like you know what you're talking about. Why don't we start, when we come before God's presence, to say we love to wave our hands and stomp our feet. I want all of that, but I want to know why I do it too. There's a totality in the intensity of our search. But can I say one more thing about that? It's not just a totality, but it's also for a necessity. Notice what he says. Remember where David is. David is not praying in the palace. David is not in the sanctuary. David is not in the confinements of a religious community. David has intentionally been dethroned, disassociated, alienated. He has been ostracized. He is lonely. He's in a desert place. There is not a tree to give him shade. There's not a rock for him to cleft beneath and get into. There is no water stream. That's the image that he is painting. He says, this is a dead, desert, desiccated place. That's where I am. But David is not just talking about a physical place. He says in the physical, we can learn something about the spiritual. That there are many people who are in luxuriant places, in their beautiful homes, riding around town, in their nice automobiles. They go to great schools and work in great corporations, but they are just like dead, dry, desiccated deserts. They are dead on the inside. But if God can bring alive the desert, then what more do you think that God can do for you? Some of you have heard about the resurrection plan. It goes under certain names, but it can be found in the Big Bend country, northeast Mexico. You can find it in the Suwannee area. And it's an ugly little plant. It is as ugly can be. It is brown and it is dry. It looked like tobacco. It's all gnawed up. And it's nothing that you want to bring saying, "Here, honey, here's a great plant." It lives with about 2, maybe 3% of water. It has very short roots. But it's called a resurrection plant because that plant can live in that condition for 2 to 3 years, just dried out. Then you can get a cup of water and pour it on that resurrection plant. And within 1 hour, it becomes a luxuriant, beautiful, verdant flower that springs forth into life. It's a reminder of God's grace. But I didn't think you would get too excited about that until I tell you this. If God in the physical world can bring to life a dried out plant, what more can God do in the spiritual world to bring back to life a dried out spirit? Tonight, maybe that's all you need to hear, is that you need to be connected to God's flowing stream in order that you can come back to life. Stop blaming it on Pastor West can't preach in the choir. They didn't sing my song and the ushers made me angry. No, it's something deeper than the superficial. Ask God, Lord, make me alive tonight. Preach, Ralph West. Bring me to life. Seek God. Seek God. But can I give you something else that David said? He said, I sought God. And I want you to seek God, but I also want you, when you tried everything so you think you have, trust God by remembering God. Notice what he says in the very next line, in verse 2 and then in verse number 5. He says, so I've looked for you in the sanctuary to see your power and your glory. And then look at what else he says here. He says in verse number 6, when I remembered you on my bed, I meditated on you in the night watches. Do you see what David is saying? He says, I'm in the wilderness. I'm separated from the sanctuary, from the holy city of Jerusalem. Ahithophel, my counselor, has betrayed me. My son, who's the mirror of my reflection, has pushed me away. I'm isolated. I'm disconnected. But he doesn't pray about take me back home. He says, in the wilderness where things are dry, teach me, Lord, how to remember you. And when I remember you, I will worship you. He remembers God through worshipfulness on one hand and wakefulness on the other hand. He says, when I go into the sanctuary, I look tonight and I want to really, and I really mean this, compliment you moms and dads for bringing your children to church tonight. It doesn't matter whether they go to sleep. It doesn't matter if they get busy. I want to thank you for that. Because you don't know what God may do with your children in a worship service. You don't know what grace God may sprinkle on your children. You don't know what God, remember him. That's what he said. He said, when I would go to the sanctuary, look at it now in verse number 2. He says, I looked for you in the sanctuary. Now, how did David do that? He had never seen God with his naked eye. But he had seen him through what he had written, what he had sang, what he had prayed. In fact, he would lift up throughout the Psalms how he would behold the very face of God, how the beauty of God would be in the sanctuary. David developed, and this is why I'm grateful that you brought your children, some sanctuary memories. That he had some sanctuary recollections that he had tucked away. Much of my life, if you would ever sit down with me, regardless of what we're talking about, somewhere I'm going to start talking about something that I learned in the sanctuary. I love going to church. I don't have to go out to the comic club. I'm not criticizing. I'm not pointing. Go wherever you want to go. But there's enough comedy in church, I just don't have to go. It's always something going on in church. Something crazy that the pastor said, and something that somebody said, something somebody did. There's always something funny, but some sanctuary memories. There's always something laughable in church, but there's also something joyful about church. The stories that we hear when somebody gives that testimony of how God has healed their body, how God is sustaining them in the face of a sickness, of how God is keeping them when trouble is on that trail, somebody that needs prayer, something laughable, something joyful. There's something about the hymn and the song that we sing. There's something about it. Some of you grew up and you used to go home and you used to play church. That's a good way to learn, church, is to play church. Stop telling your son and daughter to stop imitating Pastor West. Let them do all of what they want to do, because that's their way for God to get into their imagination. Even when they start laughing about them old songs and laughing under their breath, let them laugh all they want. Some of you laugh at it. Oh, that's church, so tired. But that's okay. Criticize it. At least you're talking about it. And one day it'll catch up with you. You'll discover that God is all that you need. Get you some sanctuary memories. Write you some notes sometime when God speaks to you. Write it in the leaf of your Bible and revisit it sometime. Go back and think about what God has said through some prayer, through some scripture, through some sermon, through some Bible study, through some song, some hymn. Go laugh about it. Go laugh at how the people shout in church. Make fun at how they dance in the pulpit. And one of these days you'll be in church. You'll say, Lord, I'm the people I used to laugh about. But when you start remembering God, you start thinking about God. You see, to remember is to recall. It is to reflect. It is to rehearse. And so in the wilderness where David was, he had enough sanctuary memories that though he was not in the sanctuary, he turned his desert into a sanctuary. He said, I'm going to show y'all how to go to church. Stop waiting on the organ and piano and the drum. You can go to church without no music. Just get in your car and start thinking about his goodness. Think about what God has done for you, not your mama, not your daddy, not your children, what the Lord has done for you. Well, Pastor West, I ain't that spiritual. I don't know how to remember. I'll give you one thing. Did he wake you up this morning? That's a good place to begin, right there, that the Lord woke me up. Remember God.
To order today's message, please visit our website at ralphdouglaswest.org, or you may call us toll-free at 1-888-377-6876. Ask for the program number you see on the screen. Be encouraged.